pretty nice out here.
Yeah,
beautiful.
Very nice.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Wait for the whole crew to come out.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I convened this unprecedented bipartisan summit of governors, senators, and members of the House Problem Solvers Caucus to try to reach a bipartisan accord on a federal infrastructure package. Although we come from different parties and different levels of government, all of us are united in our commitment to bipartisan action to rebuild America's crumbling infrastructure. And I want to thank each and every one of these leaders for their willingness to come together in a spirit of bipartisan cooperation and to explore ways that we can find common ground on this issue, which is an issue so fundamental to our economy, to our environment, and to our way of life. And I'm pleased to report that we had a terrific summit yesterday and today, and we reached agreement on a series of principles that should guide any federal infrastructure package. The first and most important thing that we agree on is that any infrastructure package should be both developed and passed with the support of both Democrats and Republicans. Second, we agreed that this bipartisan package must include investments in existing physical assets to make our communities more livable and enable us to more safely and efficiently move people, water, energy, and goods across America. Any infrastructure package must also include investments in new physical assets, broadband and digital and energy technologies to position America to create good jobs and out-innovate our competitors around the globe in the 21st century. We agreed that any federal infrastructure package must be focused on physical and digital infrastructure. And we also had a frank and productive and open dialogue on some of the biggest sticking points for any infrastructure bill, including the scope of the package, the overall cost, and how it should be paid for. We recognize that forging a bipartisan compromise on these issues will not be easy, but we all believe that it can and that it must be done. I just want to thank every one of the leaders here behind me. We had a number of others that were with us that had to leave because of schedules, but all of these leaders who joined us here in Annapolis, I want to thank them for coming together with a real sincere desire to reach common ground on this important issue. So at this time, we're going to have a number of people address you. I'm going to turn it over to my good friend and colleague from the Commonwealth of Virginia, Ralph Northam, who's going to say a few words.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you, Governor Hogan, first of all, for your hospitality. It is a beautiful day here in Annapolis, and I just want to thank you and your wife for hosting us and bringing us together in a bipartisan manner. It has certainly been a refreshing 2 days for governors to interact with our members of Congress and to discuss a topic that has been on the minds of us for years and decades, and that is infrastructure. And just to highlight the relationship that I have had over the years with Governor Hogan, we have already set precedent on how we work together, state by state, and how we work in a bipartisan manner. We have worked on Metro. We are currently working on the American Legion Bridge, and so good things are happening when we all work together. I think we all agree that infrastructure is a top priority. We had a candid discussion last night and today and talked about our priorities, especially on a state level. And we agreed that this is not a cookie-cutter situation. One size doesn't fit all. Every state brings their priorities. And so we agreed with our members of Congress that governors need to let Congress know what our needs are, how we're paying for things now, and how we intend to do that in the future. So it's a great start. It's a great initiative when we bring folks from both sides of the aisle together, and the ability for our governors to communicate with Congress really gives me a lot of hope and promise that we will move forward and address a lot of the infrastructure needs and really be the best stewards that we can of our taxpayer money. So thank you all very much for the opportunity to be here. I'd now like to turn the podium over to our senator from West Virginia, Senator Joe Manchin. Joe.
Well, thank you, Governor. Let me just say that what you see, a collection of all of us in public service, you have Democrat and Republican senators, you have Democrat and Republican congresspeople, and you have Democrat and Republican governors. This is what governing is all about, coming together and finding a common cause. There's not a greater common cause than infrastructure. If we can't come together on infrastructure in the most toxic atmosphere we've had in Washington, then we're in trouble. And let me tell you about infrastructure. Infrastructure is what makes this country great. It's what's grown this country. It's where all the opportunities, it's where the jobs come from. And we all have the needs. And we all have the ability to fix this. And we're looking together to find the solutions. Today was a great day. Again, I want to thank Governor Hogan. I want to thank his First Lady. I want to thank the staff. And I want to thank all the people in the kitchen who made the greatest Maryland crab cakes I've eaten for a long time. And it's just a pleasure to always come back to the oldest state capital in the United States, still actively working and working hard for all the people in Maryland. But this is something that was very important today. We had great presenters. Governor Hogan's put a great team together here that really presented the problems we have, the challenges we have. I can tell you this, in Washington, we will be able to come together. I have all the confidence in the world. I think this is truly a bipartisan effort. We're working in a bipartisan way to put a good infrastructure bill. We can take care of the needs of our country, and we can do it in a responsible way, and we also can take care of the opportunities the people of America need and do it in a fiscally responsible way, and that's what we're working towards. So I want to thank everybody here, all of you all, for doing such a great job, and all of my colleagues. We don't always get together that often. You would think that we're all in Congress, so the Senate and the House is always together. We're not. I want to thank No Labels. I want to thank the problem solvers and all the people that work together that gives us this opportunity. It's the greatest times that we have. We needed to be doing more of this. So without further ado, I want to introduce to you Congressman Josh Gottheimer, a leader of the problem solvers from the great state of New Jersey.
Thanks,
Josh.
Joe. Thanks, Joe. Whoops. First,
thank you so much, Governor Hogan. Thank you for having us and the First Lady of the State for, I'll tell you those, Joe's right about the crab cakes and the fact that you're giving each of them to us on the way out as a parting gift. but I do want to thank the bipartisan group of senators that have come together and all the members of the House Problem Solvers Caucus who are here for one purpose, and that's to find a bipartisan way forward on the infrastructure portion of the administration's job proposal. The Problem Solvers Caucus just released today our new bipartisan infrastructure proposal, and it was headed up by our Problem Solvers Working Group and our leaders, John Katko from New York and Connor Land from Pennsylvania, and I want to thank them both for their leadership and all the problem solvers who are behind me, who the Democrats and Republicans, and there's 29 Democrats and 29 Republicans in the House Problem Solvers Caucus with us is Dean Phillips and Abigail Spamberger, Tom Swazi, Carolyn Bordeaux, Jared Golden, and Susie Lee. I also mentioned Connor Lamb. Our caucus's new report really helps us focus the scope of bipartisan infrastructure agreement, right? What exactly, there are three legs here. The first part is how do we focus this down so we can all start our agreement there? Then we also are gonna have to, as we move forward, look at two other pieces. What should it cost? What do we actually need to spend? And then of course, how do we pay for it? This will be an ongoing conversation, but the first portion of the scope, which was such a big part of our discussion today, is so critical. The caucus will, in the weeks and days ahead, continue working around the clock as we have been to get a bipartisan deal done on this infrastructure package. It can be done, and as Joe said, it must get done. The survival of our country depends on bipartisan solutions and bipartisan governing. I know that with everyone working together, as we have been and we will continue, and the greatest country in the world, our best days will be ahead. And I'm so honored to introduce the co-chair of the Problem Solvers Caucus, my good friend from Pennsylvania, Brian Fitzpatrick.
Governor Hogan, again, on behalf of all of us, thank you for your hospitality, for UME's hospitality. Your staff is just awesome. Everybody should know that. The governor is an amazing staff who did a lot of good work. Josh had mentioned the Democrat members of our caucus On the GOP side, we have Representatives Katko, Rice, Upton, Gonzalez, Colon, Herrera, Butler, Valadeo, and Taylor. And as Josh had stated, we're taking a very structured approach here. Number one is defining infrastructure. Number two is coming up with an overall cost that we are all comfortable with, but that needs to be driven by what we need for each individual bucket of infrastructure. And that needs to be driven by facts and data and evidence and experts. Not pulling numbers out of the sky, but actually coming up with the numbers that we need. What is the number we need for broadband? What is the number we need for roads and bridges? And have that drive the ultimate outcome. And lastly is how to pay for it. And the reality is, we have to come up with a bipartisan solution, which means nobody's going to get everything they want. We'd rather, as we always say, get 80% of something than 100% of nothing. I want to thank Senator Manchin for doing what he always does, which is inject a whole lot of common sense into the thought process and the solution. We need more of that. And again, Governor Hogan, thank you for everything you did for us. And this is a beginning. This is not the end. We got a lot of work to do, but we'd made a lot of good progress. There was a lot of really good cross-pollination. As Senator Manchin said, just spending time with each other and hearing each other think is very helpful. Thanks, Governor.
Well, thank you very much. I know a number of the members of Congress have got to leave to fly back to their districts. Some people got tight schedules, but we'll be happy to take a couple of questions before folks have to roll out, if anybody has any. Never seen such quiet folks. Well, sure. I'll let one of the problem solvers in Congress jump up here in a second to answer what's the next step. You know, as several of the speakers said, this really is an important first step. And it's a very unusual thing, really, when you have governors, senators, and congressmen from both parties sitting down and having real discussions. It doesn't happen very often. I can't remember it happening. And so that's the first step in agreeing on some general principles about what infrastructure is and what it isn't, about the size and scope, and about the fact that it has to be bipartisan. But there's a lot more work to be done. We didn't solve all the problems of exactly what it's going to cost and how we're going to pay for it. But, we've just come up with a set of principles. And, you know, we're going to continue to provide input from the National Governors Association. We're going to work with all of our leaders in Congress. But really, it's in their court for the House and the Senate to figure this out. So maybe Senator Manchin and maybe one of the problem solvers leaders from the House would want to talk. Yeah, we did talk a lot about, I gave the examples in Maryland about how we've been able to both utilize federal dollars and our state funds along with private sector investment that by, you know, building the largest P3 transit project in North America with federal, state, and local dollars and private sector investment for our traffic relief plan, which is the biggest one in North America. That's we're utilizing private dollars, but it's a balanced approach. We have 800 projects currently under construction in Maryland, totaling $9 billion, and that only happens with help from the federal government, state and local governments all working together. So with that, we'll turn it over to maybe Senator Manchin.
Let me just first of all make sure you all know who all was here from the Senate anyway. We had Senator Cornyn here from Texas. We had Senator Collins from Maine. We had Senator Cassidy from Louisiana, Senator Rosen from Nevada, Senator Romney from Utah, and Senator Young from Indiana. The thing this allowed us to do is basically talk to the people on the front line. Being a former governor, that I know that whatever happened in Washington, we had to implement it or live with it or try to make some adjustments or ask for waivers to make it fit in our scheme of things that we needed. We can prevent that from happening if we start coordinating what we're doing. So in the Senate, we have a working group. We have 10 Republicans and 10 Democrats. We call it the G20 group. And we meet consistently. And we have the problem solvers with Josh and Brian coming over working with us. So we're working in a bipartisan, bicameral way to have the executive branch of the governors, the NGA, involved truly completes that triangle. It helps us have good input so we don't have redundancies or waste. And that's really what we're achieving and trying to achieve and set a way forward. And I think that today was a tremendous start for that. Josh?
No, I think you covered it. I mean, but I think our whole goal here is to work together, not just Democrats and Republicans, but working with the Senate, Democrats and Republicans, as we do, and we did on this past winter and going to the new year on the COVID package. And that's the model, right? This is the model on how you govern, not just on this issue, but frankly on every issue. Working together across the aisle and across chambers and working with our governors and with our mayors and our local communities. That's how you actually get things done, and it's how you bring the country together.
Any other questions? Maybe a couple more? Well, so we've invested more money in the city of Baltimore in transportation than any other jurisdiction in the state. We continue to do that. That's thanks to the help of the federal government. We're also building the largest P3 transit system in America in the Washington metropolitan area in Prince George's and Montgomery counties. And it really is a great partnership at the federal, state, and local level, and in some cases with the private sector as well. We couldn't do it without them. And that's why this summit is so important, is why I decided to convene this. You know, I am a national co-chair of No Labels. I've had the opportunity to work with both the bicameral, with these senators who really want to find compromise, with the problem solvers in the House. And, you know, I led a year-long infrastructure initiative through the NGA with my fellow governors, Governor Northam, and all 50 governors really came together on a set of principles. And so it's if we can find bipartisan compromise in Congress on this, I think it's something that would be applauded by all the governors and would certainly help us here in Maryland. Mm-hmm.
Do you envision actually having a plan at some point to present
to
congressional leadership and President
Biden? Well, we presented the NGA plan already to talked to President Biden about this in the Oval Office. We presented it to Secretary Buttigieg. I testified before the Senate. And we submitted that to all the folks here. That's the NGA's proposals, a lot of which I think that there's agreement among all the governors, and I think most of the folks here that those are good principles. Both the folks in the Senate on both sides, and Senator Cassidy was unfortunately had to leave right before this, but he and Senator Manchin and their colleagues weighed in with some great stuff in the Senate that I think we agree with, and the problem solvers, they're rolling out their plan today from the House. And so, you know, we don't have a detailed plan today. We have a set of principles we all agree on, but I think we're going to get there. This is the first step in the process.
Let me say one thing, I think where you're going with this and wanting to know, the president put out a conceptual plan. A bill's not been written, but it's a conceptual, $2.25 trillion. You've seen that. It's not only infrastructure, which we think is conventional infrastructure, but human infrastructure. We believe that we should take step by step. So we're going to do infrastructure. When I say infrastructure, this is what we have come to understand and what we think the greatest need we have now that can be done in a bipartisan way is conventional infrastructure. Whether it's the water, sewer, roads, bridges, internet, things that we know that need to be repaired, be fixed, and basically the deferred maintenance has been going on for far too long. We can move into those other areas also. Now, whether that'll be as much of a cooperation on that as there is on this. So why don't you take the greatest need that we have and do it on something that we all agree on? That's what we've come to an agreement on, I think, more than anything else today.
Last question, please.
Wait, Brian's going to jump in.
Yeah, and just I wanted to just offer an additional GOP perspective on it. I just want to emphasize, so we have, as the problem solvers, we are on the House side, 58 members. We have 29 Democrats and 29 Republicans. We have a caucus rule that if 75% of us agree to a concept, or in this case an infrastructure framework, we as a 58-member centrist bloc in the House agree to together get behind it, and we have that framework now. So the question now is, now's the hard part. Now that we have the framework, we got to start doing those three buckets, as Josh and I talked about. We got to come up with the number that we need and then figure out how to raise the revenue or close the gaps in order to cover that, because we want to be responsible about it. If infrastructure is done the right way, it is an investment. It's not an expense. If done the right way, we got to figure out what that right way is. And it takes a lot of work to come up with the numbers and the scope. It doesn't happen in a day or a week. It's going to take a lot of work to get there. But if done the right way and we make smart investments, it will yield a return for us rather than being an expense.
Now, last question, please.
I think the congresswoman should say something, because if the congressmen are united, we're all united.
Yeah, we can take one last question, but to follow up on that point that Congressman Fitzpatrick just talked about, you know, this is a serious thing when you have 58 centrist members of Congress willing to work together and willing to vote in a block. I don't have to tell you that, you know, they're going to have to work with the folks in the Problem Solvers Caucus. You know, with Joe Manchin saying this is that he wants to work together with all of us in the Senate. You know, with the tight majorities we have, never has it been more important for us to work together in a bipartisan way. And I think we all have agreement that that's what we want to do. Mackenzie. I don't know. We'll see.
He's a local reporter.
You guys want to go take that? Anybody? Go.
The bottom line is that's happening as we speak. We're starting to form that right now. You saw the Republican plan came out. Okay, we're working in the G20, which is the 10 D's and 10 R's who are more inclined to do something on a infrastructure only. So we'll take the Republican, the Democrats, if let's say the Democrat leadership takes the 2.25 conceptual, puts that into a bill. Usually you find roadblocks there, the same as we did last December when we couldn't get past a half a trillion for the new COVID package from the Republicans, 1.3 from the Democrats. We got together and broke that roadblock and came up with $908 billion. I envision maybe the same thing happening, but I think the White House is receptive to us for them to understand that we really, truly believe that we should do a conventional infrastructure bill that can be done bipartisan. They have an appetite to want to do something bipartisan. This is doable. The other things that are conceptual, we can work on piece by piece, committee by committee. And the only thing I would say on that, in the Senate, the way we work, it has to get back to a committee process to where these bills should go to the committee, they should have hearings, markups, come back to the Senate floor with an open amendment process, which is germane to the subject matter. When you do that, everybody has input, and it brings people together because they get all of their concerns and frustrations out through a voting process, not through a dialogue against each other.
Thank you.